podcast. This is episode 76, and as always, I have here with me my co-host Artus. Oh wait, it's not Artus. Okay, unfortunately, Artus is a bit ill, but I hope he recovers soon. But fortunately, I have here with me Johnny Mast from Netherlands. Hello, Johnny. How are you doing?
I'm fine. So. Yeah, my name is Johnny. I'm 34 years old, but I have like 26 years old in development already. Oh my God, I saw myself. So that's one thing I'm not used to. So yeah, my name is Johnny. 26 years old in development, 1991 or 1990. I wrote my first line of code and
With 8 years old, is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. And the first thing I made was a BIOS reset tool.
BIOS reset tool. Okay. In PHP, right?
No, it was BASIC back then. Okay. Just started in 1993, if I'm right.
I'm trying to be cynic. Anyway, we are here to talk about PHP. And this month we have actually a quite good bunch of topics. And let me start. Let's see if the Google Hangouts can share the screen this month correctly, because every other month it's a challenge to make it work right. So, sharing the screen is in Hangouts, if it lets me. So, if this is right, okay, are you?
Yeah, I can see it.
Able to?
Yeah,
I can. Okay. Thanks. Okay, as usual, we are going to start with the latest topics. Latest PHP revisions, PHP 5.626. And then we'll also cover the latest PHP 7.0.11 in this case. And we also mentioned briefly some RCs for PHP 7.1 that start coming out. And actually, there are a few after this one, but we'll just mention it because not everybody is ready to test PHP. So one of the interesting topics that we are going to comment is the announcement from Dmitry Stogov, a Zend developer, that mentioned that he's going to work on a JIT engine for PHP, eventually to be released with PHP 8. So things are looking better for PHP, and we'll talk about it in a moment.
Wow.
Then we are going to also talk about a proposal that solves a great headache of many developers that want to try new versions of PHP, but at the same time they need to run older versions for other applications in the same web server. So there's a proposal here to solve that problem. Another topic that actually we mentioned before is the possibility to use some sort of caching the PHP engine, so on different requests it can restart after the bootstrapping code, which could be some, for instance, loading the autoloader code or some framework bootstrapping that you may be using. So this eventually will make PHP applications a bit faster. Another topic is about the unique ID function that is not really so unique. So there are some proposals to improve the uniqueness of that function return values. And after that, there is a proposal proposal to handle better the way PHP internally hashes the array values to avoid one type of attack that was sort of fixed. Well, it was not fixed, it was just a workaround about PHP 5.3.9 or something like that. Then we actually move on to an RFC. Actually, it is not yet an RFC, it is just a proposal regarding strict comparisons of values in PHP 7. And you also comment about one bug that Johnny found out related to this topic. And finally, we also discussed a proposal to have built-in request and response objects. Usually these objects are created by frameworks that wrap, I would say, the handling of request values and the output of the current request, but the idea is to have this built in PHP. In PHP, eventually 7.2 or PHP 8. Well, let's see what happens. So back to the first topic, which is about the PHP versions. As usual, we had some maintenance releases for PHP 5.6, and over here we can see, let me increase the font, we can see that there are some, I would say, mostly security fixes probably, or maybe also some fixes that are not related with security. Then we also have somewhat a similar list for PHP 7.0, but probably some more bug fixes related specific of PHP 7.0. Johnny, which versions are you using in your projects? Do you have freedom or depends on your customers?
Depends. We are working with another company, so that means that they have two standard, just like PHP itself, they have a branch or two branches of PHP that they have installed and where we install the web hosting on. And but at this moment it's just PHP 5 and 5.6. So I want, with all my heart, I want to work with PHP 7, but it's not possible yet. So they're still on those big servers, they're still testing out PHP 7. It will come soon, but we are still not having PHP 7 in our default package. If that would be the case, I would be the first to use that PHP version. But right now I'm using PHP 6 standard. I don't know exactly. It could be, if I'm correct, the 21 release of 5.6. If, let me see, there was even a release. I think so. Yeah, that should have been an older release. So 5.6.21.
Yeah.
I just noticed something, by the way, in the 5.6.21 changelog, where it mentions JSON, where it reads out of bounds. There was also, I don't know if it's fixed already, there was also a bug where you did a JSON encode, and it would totally... it was a serialized bug, where you have these numbers that indicate a string length that you're of an array value. and it would be totally out of bound. It would, if you had like special characters in your array values, it would make the serialized string, how do you say, corrupt. Just the first thing I thought about when I saw the JSON thing, but I misread, and this was, of course, about JSON and not about serializing objects. But
okay,
yeah.
Well, anyway, we are also just mentioned briefly. There are already a few RC release candidates for PHP 7.1. So I think everything is on schedule for PHP 7.1 to be released sometime later this year.
In December, isn't it? December.
Yeah, but we are in RC1, so I think it's well ahead to be released sometime soon.
Yeah.
Okay, regarding PHP versions, this is what we have. So let's move on to the next topic, on which we are going to comment about one interesting announcement from Dmitry Stogov. For those that are not aware, Dmitry Stogov is one of PHP core developers. He works for Zend, and he announced that he is working on a JIT engine for PHP. Actually, the JIT engine was meant somehow to be introduced for PHP 7 because, for instance, Facebook hack already features a JIT engine. But then Dmitry found out that it also could improve the performance of PHP some other ways. Besides implementing a JIT engine. So now that several other improvements were done, he's getting back to this JIT engine. So for those that are not familiar with the concept of a JIT engine, basically, it is a process that compiles the PHP code into native machine code, of the underlying CPU of the machine that it is running. So this eventually will run much faster, but then it may not be the case. And sometimes it may pay to use a JIT engine. In others, it may not be worth the overhead of compiling. But anyway, this is progress, not just because there is another great opportunity for PHP to improve its performance, but also since Zend company was sold last year to a bigger group, and even one of the founders, Andy Goodman's, left the company to work. Some developers were concerned, how will they still invest on the development of new PHP versions? So this announcement was a sort of relief, as in the parent company, I think it's Rockwave, I'm not sure. They are investing on PHP because they really want to make it as best as possible for their customers. So personally, I think this is a great announcement. Johnny, how do you see this announcement? Is it clear for you what is going on, or maybe it's not so clear of the importance of this announcement?
Well, I'm a bit mixed on this because I have no idea what to expect yet. When I read this news or this article, they mention debugging, performance, and stuff like that. I know that HVM has a lot of speed over PHP, even PHP 7. So it could be a good thing, but then also I can't wait for it. So I don't know. I'm not really hyped yet on it. I think it's a good development, but I still have to do a little bit more research on this subject to have a really good opinion.
Yeah. Well, once this is implemented, it will be all transparent for the user. So there are no changes in the language itself. It's just the way PHP is executed at runtime. So you don't have to be concerned if there will be like backwards compatibility breaks. Nothing of that will happen. It's just one improvement on the runtime engine that is being tested. As I mentioned, Facebook Hack language, which is a sort of a derivative from PHP, already features a JIT engine. Node.js, which is based on Google V8 engine, also implements a great JIT engine. So this is sort of the core PHP catching up on the latest trends in terms of performance, how to take the most out of the performance of the underlying machine.
Right.
Anyway, this is a good thing.
We have one question from the chat.
Yeah, great. Good to know that you are paying attention, because I have so many windows that I did not even...
The question is from, I hope I will spell your name correct. Ada Ruby, I hope so.
Yeah.
Will the JIT engine replace the current Zend engine? Well, probably not.
Yes. Right, you are getting it right. This is like one step on the execution of PHP. So the underlying Zend engine will be sort of extended. The way it works nowadays, PHP source code is parsed and converted into a sort of assembly language, which is not native to the CPU. It's what it's called opcodes. And these opcodes, they remain in memory. If you have a caching extension like the opcache that was introduced in PHP 5.5 or maybe others that were existed before, codes remain in memory. So on the next time the PHP code is executed, the PHP code, the source code, will not be parsed again. So it will execute that code directly in memory. So this JIT engine, it's a new step. It's something on top of that. Basically, it will take the opcodes and convert them into native machine code. So when PHP is going to execute a code excerpt, like code inside a function, if it is already compiled into native machine code, it will run faster.
Yeah.
Of course, this in practice may not be noticeable. For instance, if you are accessing a database, when you execute code that accesses the database, PHP code has to wait for the database server to return the response. So PHP will not wait faster. Just wait whatever time the database takes to execute. So for pure CPU tasks, it might be faster. If you have a lot of input and output operations like databases, file accesses, network accesses, the improvement may not be so noticeable. But still, it is an improvement that will give a certain average gain of performance. I'm sure there will be people that will sort of benchmarking it. To, like, for instance, let's benchmark WordPress to see how much faster it runs with the JIT engine. And that is basically what will happen. You don't have to change anything in your code. Probably the engine will be smart to the point of measuring the actual gains of time.
Yeah, and that's exactly like you saw when PHP 7 came out, or building up to the release of PHP 7. We see all those graphs comparing PHP 7 to HHVM.
Yeah.
And it will be just like that when PHP 8 or even the JIT compiler will arrive. So it's just a way to optimize that op cache, so it can execute the code faster. So that's
yeah. It. Yeah. So don't be concerned, because the progress of PHP will be forwards, not backwards. PHP already has many people saying bad things against it. It doesn't need to get worse, and it won't. So don't worry. Anyway, moving on to the next topic, as I was saying, just let me share the screen again. Yeah, where are the
non-conflicting builds.
Yes, exactly. Just wanted to share it with the everybody. I hope you are seeing it now. So basically, what is being proposed here is a change that will allow PHP to run on the same web server with different versions. I'm not sure how this will work in practice, but that's the idea, like having different builds of PHP on the same web server.
This is not the responsibility, I think, of PHP. To do this.
Yeah, but you know, if let's imagine that you have a customer that as part of an application in the same web server running PHP 5, but a new application wants to run PHP 7, it would not be very efficient to run separate web servers or some separate fast GGI engine just to be able to continue to use different versions on the same web server for different applications.
Well, there is one really easy thing that I can think of that would be fix this, or at least two, and then one extra comment. One is, you can use Nginx just to proxy to two different versions of Apache running on two ports. So then you have your two PHP versions. You can also use Plesk, and you can just select your PHP version that you run. And then finally, my comment is, it's just the responsibility of the, I know this is could be a good feature, it could be kindness of the core team, but I don't think it would be very practical, because then you have to use your, if I'm reading the document right, then use a bin, PHP will be PHP 5 binary, I guess. So then all of your scripts will break at this point, because all the interpreters are using user bin PHP. So I think it's just the responsibility of let's say, for example, Debian or Ubuntu, just to put them in the right direction and rename the files accordingly. So, but that's my opinion, I don't know.
But well, I think this is meant, for instance, when you just want to use one Apache server, not fast CGI or some other Nginx acting as a proxy. Because the proxy is more when you want to use the same IP address for getting requests, and depending on the URL and the host, it will redirect to a different fast CGI. Whatever is the equivalent that you're using on the background. Because, for instance, in shared hosting, okay, you can use Fast CGI, but most people use Apache. And,
well, if they can run as well.
Sorry?
That's changing as well, because we are using Fast CGI with the Nginx in front of it.
Yes, that's because you can. because in shared hosting, people don't have much control.
So we're getting the question, how about using containers to fix that issue? Well, it's basically the same as proxying.
I don't use containers because I control my own servers and I don't use multiple PHP versions. So this is not really a problem that I have. Do you use any containers? I suppose you mean Docker or something.
Yeah. Well, that's basically comes down to what my first my first solution. If you look
at it's something that I'm not using. I know that it's very popular, but since I never used it, I'm not the right person to comment. But that's, I suppose containers just use a different container for whatever PHP version that you want to run. The containers are like a sort of virtual machines. Well, not really virtual, but something that you can use to run PHP on different virtual environments that would be separate. Well, I don't know. That's, for me, virtual machines is, as mentioned, some performance will be lost. Anyway, if you are in shared hosting, you should not be concerned with performance because you're already paying the cheapest possibility to run PHP. If you really want performance, forget shared hosting. You need to move on to something, at least virtual private servers or dedicated servers. So this here is more to help people that just want to have one shared hosting account and be able to choose the PHP version that they want to run, PHP 5 or PHP 7. And hopefully not having to migrate all their applications at once. You can just migrate one at a time. So I think this is a positive thing, but I'm not sure of all the consequences of this. Will somehow these PHP versions run slower because of this flexibility? Probably not, but this is a new proposal, so it needs to be studied.
Right.
Okay. Well, moving on to another topic, which is basically something that we already covered in the I'm looking at the chat and I'm laughing. Okay. Anyway, I'm trying to share the right screen here. Now, with live coding at the same time, I have like three copies of myself on different windows, so I need to figure which one is the right one. Oh, no, that was the wrong one. where is it? Okay, this is the one. Anyway, single point entry apps is a different name for something that was proposed before. Basically, this would be the possibility to have a certain point in your code on which you would be having a statement. Let me go. I try to find a code of example that the person presented. It would be like having a special require of statement for let's say your Bootstrap code. If you use a framework, you have a Bootstrap script that you need to run on every request. And if you can run that code and the PHP engine could freeze the state of the request there, so wow, you can restart. I'm not finding the example code here. I don't know. But anyway, the idea is that you avoid the overhead of having to run the same Bootstrap code in your application.
It would be like if you are bootstrapping your all your composer packages, and you would just freeze it in time, and you would be able to just read from the code in I don't know, read only memory or something.
Yeah,
basically like that. And the first thing that came to my mind was, wow, that sounds a bit like Node. I don't know why. I have no experience, real experience with Node.js, but I don't know. It's just one of those terms that would be used in that kind of environment, I guess. I'm a very old PHP guy myself. I came from...
You're not old.
Well, in the amount of time that I'm working with PHP, also in my line, yeah, in my profession. So it must be me, or all those fancy things are coming up that not always do I think like that could actually be a good thing. But on this one, I think on one side, it's just like the JIT engine we talked about before. It could be a really, really, really good thing. On the other side, it could be too fancy as well for its time right now. I don't know. I don't know. Well, it sounds too sci-fi.
No, it's not really that complicated, and it's not exactly the same as Node.js, because Node.js is some code that never stops running, unless it crashes, of course. But then there must be some process in place to restart it when it crashes. Anyway, but the Node.js, what it will do is like, since it is running the same code over again and never reload it on the different requests, whatever you have loaded in variables or something from the previous requests, it will remain there for the following requests. In this case, the PHP engine would be restarted on every request, but it will jump right to a certain state that it would be as if it has already loaded, executed the Bootstrap code, whatever it could be. Could be some complicated Bootstrap script that would create some objects, like you do when you use certain frameworks. But could also be just loading your autoloader code that probably is very long because you have assembled a lot of packages in your application, and the autoloader probably generated by Composer will load a long array of classes and map them to whatever is
right
is the script. Well, I don't know if there is much gain, because nowadays Composer generates just a single array for the mapping of classes to scripts. Probably what is more expensive is the actual loading of the scripts. If you load many classes at once, but well, But then it's a problem of the application itself. Well, why do you need 100 classes or just two? It's up to your application. But the idea here is to be independent of the application, so you don't have to be concerned with the overhead of running your Bootstrap code.
Yeah, it would be cool.
Yes, this is a topic that has been rehashed. There were proposals before, and I think there is a link here to a previous discussion that was held like in April. And the idea is to implement what is called a startup snapshot, which the JavaScript and V8 engine uses. So this is different. This is not exactly the same what you do with Node.js, despite Node.js uses V8 engine. So the idea, okay, there is some code here that you, instead of using the require vendor autoload, you would have a new call like a Bootstrap on this code, and it would be like running some this code and freeze the state of the PHP engine, so next time it doesn't have so much overhead. And anyway, this, there was a long discussion about this then. I think sooner or later something will be implementing along these lines. And I have been talking here a lot and was not sharing the screen of them.
Just shared the link in the chat so people can check it out now.
Yeah, so, okay. So next time I forget to share the screen, just remind me. Because this happens once in a while. So anyway, the code that I was talking about, it is this one. Okay, instead of having a require, you have something like Bootstrap, vendor autoload, and it would cache the context after running the script. So, and here you, or something like this, like Bootstrap, and then you define some code that would be run as your Bootstrap code for your application. Okay, these are just suggestions for things to be implemented in the future. Maybe, I don't know if there will be a PHP 7.2 or PHP will jump to PHP 8. Right after PHP 7.1, but okay, this is something for the future. Let's see what will happen. Anyway, I'm going to move on, and the challenge of sharing the right window again. I think I will stop not sharing the screen. So over here is another topic that is being discussed, which is the fact that the unique ID function is not very unique at all, as claims this core developer, Yasu Hogakian. He suggests adding a few more things to make it more unique. I don't know, maybe this will be a good idea, or maybe this will probably make the code a bit slower, and I don't know. I don't remember many cases I've used this function. Johnny, do you remember using this function for any purpose in your applications?
No. If I need a unique hash, I will make it myself. I didn't even know this function existed, to be honest.
Okay, well, you know PHP language.
Well, in PHP you learn every day. I have a team of like two other developers, and almost at least once or twice a month, we are like, "Oh, did you know this function existed?" And yeah. I know it's strange because I'm developing for so many years, but if you move on from you have your own style of development, and if you move on, you need something else. Only then you start looking for new things to learn. In my case, I make open source, a lot of open source classes outside of my work. But in those cases, I don't need it as well. So I've never used this unique ID function. Never, I think.
Yeah, well, maybe. Well, there are functions in PHP that, for instance, if you want to create a temporary file, it generates a file with a unique name in some temporary directory. But there's a function for that. You don't need to use this this unique ID function. And well, it depends, unique compared to what. And anyway, just regarding functions that you may not know, there's a thread in, I think it was in Quora, about what is the, something like what is the most amazing function of PHP that you have learned about. And I have commented about one function that most people do not know. It is actually, there are two functions. One is strspn, and there is strcspn. And basically what it does is to tell the length of a string that contains a set of characters or not. And this is very useful when you are implementing your own parser for some format. Like, let's say if you want to parse some text, and you have like a unique, a variable name, and you know that variable names have to have like letters, digits, and scores, and you need to know in the string where the identifier ends, and with this you can this function the strspan or strcspan, you can just pass a list of characters that may be contained in the string that you want to parse or not, and it tell exactly where that string ends. And I have used this, like, for instance, to implement a MIME parser class. You know, when you need to parse email, you need to have some kind of parser for MIME messages. Well, PHP has some functions to parse email messages, but if there is a mistake, it is not very tolerant. So I developed my own parser, and I use this a lot, this function a lot, because I have to parse, for instance, headers, header names, header values, and this function was very useful. And then people realize, oh, this is much, much faster than using regular expressions, because when you use regular expressions, you are actually using a whole compiler engine. That is the regular expression processing engine, and there is a great overhead, but since in PHP is very simple, because it's just like one line to process some text with a regular expression, people are not aware that it may be actually very slow depending on what you are doing. Anyway, this was just one example of some weird function that most people never heard, but it's there like since PHP 2 or 3 or something. Okay, so moving on to the next topic, which is about a proposal I wish I had the original link to the topic, but I missed. But basically, it's about the way PHP handles arrays. As you may remember or not, in PHP like 5.5, somebody announced there is a vulnerability, not just in PHP, but in many different languages, in the way they handle arrays. For instance, your requests sent to PHP, they'll build the GET and POST arrays, and you could craft a request with thousands of values. If they had a special name in the request, the parameter keys, like your post values, if they have special names, they will make the way PHP accesses array very, very slow, till probably it halts your machine. And this was very concerned because with a simple request, you could simply stop the web server. And the solution that was found then is to limit the number of request parameters. Like, you cannot have more than 1,000 parameters in your post requests. Well, most post requests just use a few parameters. But if an attacker could send a request with many parameters, that would be a problem. So the solution by then was to limit to, I think the default is 1,000, which is a lot. But if you want to change the default for some reason, you can do that as well. But still, it was not a solution. It was a workaround. It's just to minimize the eventual attacks, so it does not become so slow. But this time, there was another proposal to use a different hashing algorithm. They call SIT hash. And there was a discussion in PHP internals whether this would be a good thing or not. Would it slow down the way PHP accesses arrays or not? So this is still being discussed. I don't know if there will be a move to use this different hashing algorithm. Anyway, this is something very low level. Most PHP developers would probably don't have a good understanding of what this means. So, just to be aware that somebody is trying to make things better. And yet again, if anything of this is implemented, it will not affect the way you run your code. There is the topic of discussion of this, and there was some discussion about it, whether it would be a good idea to implement it or not. Well, let's see what happens after this. Okay, now moving on to a different topic, which is a proposal called strict comparisons. Basically, the idea is to declare strict comparisons and the point here is to, I think, to throw an exception when you are comparing values of different types. Like you have a string and you are comparing it with a number.
Yeah, you would get a type error.
Yes. Well, if this was implemented, of course, this is not yet implemented. The way it is working now, I think the string year would be promoted to an integer, and it would be compared with another integer. So this, the idea is to make it more strict in the sense that if you probably have a bug in your code because you missed some variables, it will be more robust. Well, personally, I'm not yet using strict types, but it probably could be a good idea. I don't know, John, in your code, do you use, I mean, PHP 7 code, are you using strict types or not?
I do for testing, because open source means that you get a lot of faces looking in your code. So instead of pure, I use interfaces a lot in open source. So that gives you the types, and PHP will automatically, PHP 7 will automatically break in your tests if you don't use your type, correct types. So in a way, yes, I do use strict and strict types, and I do test for them, because if you go to any package I make and you're using adapters, you want to make sure that if you test your code, and you want to make sure that the right type of argument is passed to a function. So yeah, I do that. I use strict, but I never declare any strict. I only test for it, and I don't know why. Probably because I'm making my PHP work. I'm working on PHP 5.6 and PHP 7, also 7.1 since recently. But if I would declare a strict, my code would probably break on lower PHP version, because I don't know if the strict declaration is or even the declare keyword is in the lower version.
No, I think the declare keyword, yes, but if you declare the types on your functions or whatever code you are using.
I was checking.
The declare not, but the types in the your functions, probably it will.
Yeah, that's if you use pure type hinting. But the type of type hinting that looks like action script with return values, that type of stuff.
Okay.
I was more talking about passing types. That was what I was referring, and not really type hinting. So I'm sorry.
So you use type hinting, you enable type hinting on your development, but what about in production?
That's a good question. That's also, there is not many time to implement it in rapid development. At least when you're not using test-driven development, that's not what I'm doing at the moment. I wish I would have the time, but just like many developers, we are working at companies that isn't in the big city where they have all the time in the world just to let you write your code. What we do is we test it, double test it, but not with
automated tests.
Not with automated tests, but
you are not going to heaven, because the gods will not tolerate that.
But I can make it up a little bit, because all of my open source packages are automatically tested, except my latest JIT. A quick project on PHP classes that I did as a request from our user. So I made this package for him. So I
Okay, don't worry, because I believe the vast majority of developers are not using testing in practice. Although they understand the value of using tests to catch bugs sooner, as you said, it's an expense. It takes more time to actually develop the tests. Sometimes the tests take more time to develop the actual code, but okay, there are tools out there. There are tools out there. If you use them, you will probably benefit from that. But it also depends on your employer. Do they allow you to spend time writing tests, or maybe they want to rush the code as fast as possible and let it break in production?
Most of my personal part of it within the company is doing the really complex migrations and stuff like that. You would think, but migrations is not only always a process that's always running. It could be migrating data from all sort of places and combining it into a stream and injecting it in a new database or something. So I'm doing a lot of migrations, just like a system administrator would. And I'm also doing website development. So
Well, migrations suck, at least for me. But once in a while, you have to do them and pray that they work in the end. If they don't work, you will always be like stuck. You mentioned something here. Okay, let me check. It seems the string was a bit stuck. I don't know.
Yeah. Oh wait. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. It's back, I think.
Yeah.
But it was just the image. Anyway, you want to talk about a bug that you found out in some code?
Yeah, this is a really interesting bug, and it could be compliant with the strict comparisons, because I was let me.
Do you want to share the screen? Do you know how to share your screen to show the code?
Yes, I could. Hold on. Screen share. I would put my code here.
You have to figure which window to share.
Okay. All right. I think my code would be on the screen now.
Not yet.
Okay, because I'm seeing it in the...
Okay. It is on the screen. Can you just increase the font?
Maybe. I hope so.
It's like this? Usually control plus.
Yeah, I did control plus.
Go ahead. More.
Okay.
If you can increase it more.
Okay, this should be it. I hope. Because it's really big now. Yeah, let me try one more time. Okay.
Okay, it's large enough to read.
All right. This is a sandbox project in my GitHub repository. This will turn into a project someday. Manuel, I already told you about this project. This will be the filter function class that I really talked about some time ago. But during the development of this function or class package, I just noticed a difference in usort results. Because if you have a usort callback function, which might look like, let me see, here's the bug that I found. I hope. All right. 70289, and why this is special is that with PHP 5 and 7, the devs say that there is no difference in usort, but actually there is. If you have a function that returns 0 from a callback, then it would place your array index on the back of the target sorting array. But on PHP 7, that's different. It will act like a minus 1 on PHP 5.6. So that means that you're testing your code with a new item in an array, sorted. You expect it to be the last item, but it turns out to be the first item. And the core, the development team of PHP and the users are still debating if this is a bug or not. And they said, yeah, they closed it for now. So you cannot rely on usort, in my opinion. And that's why I made my own multi-sort function. So
it a bug? Was it considered a bug or not?
Yeah, that's still debatable, because some lines they say, okay, this is a bug in the comments, and the next they say, oh no, it's not a bug. It's a change of opinion or a change of policy. And then the next say again, it's a bug, and then so it's closed for now, and it exists in PHP 7 and HHVM, and I like the title of the bug says as well. I didn't report this; somebody else found this different sort in PHP 7 and HHVM compared to PHP 5. So. Yeah, watch out with if you do some usort and you rely on it, make sure that you're comparing integers against integers, and that it should never fail, because and better would be if you use the declare strict if it comes out in with the later PHP version, because you have to be really careful about this. I just happened to make my own custom version of the classic callback function. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I probably didn't explain it that well, but
yeah, I get it. You like to compare values as strings, not.
Yeah, well, you have to make. I wanted to compare it as numbers. But the core problem is that if you have A, B, and C as indexes in your, or 1, 2, 3 in your array, and you add the 3 as last, and you do a unit test on it, it could be, if you use the classic compare usort, hold on,
yeah,
php.net/u. If you use a classic function like this, this would be different on PHP 7, because this would mean sometimes that it would be, if it's equal, then it returns a filtered function before it acts like a minus 1. So it places the value in front, while it's in PHP 5, it places behind. So that's my bug that I ran into.
So it's your bug or PHP bug?
Yeah, it's a nasty one. And I'm still not sure how how to, what the really, what they really think about this. If that's what, if this was really changed, or if this is a bug.
Well, if they closed it, it's because they did not consider a bug. That happens, and sometimes it's frustrating because they don't interpret things the same way you do. But okay, and never mind. You have a workaround, which is to rely on your own code.
Yeah.
Okay. So moving on to one last topic, which is about a proposal from Paul Jones, a well-known framework developer, that propose to have like standard request and response objects in PHP. There are no such things. You would have to access posts, get, and whatever request variables, and deal with your output whatever way you need, maybe using buffering or something like that. It depends on what you do. But the idea here is to have built-in request and response objects for PHP. Because many frameworks actually implement these request and response objects. So the idea is to avoid that frameworks do not have to implement these types of objects over and over again on different frameworks, and then there are differences between them. So if there was a standard request and response object, it would be better for all those that are
basically used. There is, because there would be a native version of PSR 7, if I'm correct.
Oh, but PSRs are not PHP Core development. It's like a proposal for something.
Yeah, that's correct. That's correct. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, just saying that that's a proposal, and PHP Core development is independent of PSR. And even PSR, not everybody that supported the PHP fig follows all the PSRs. And, this would be to make it standard in PHP rather than having something external. So right. This is the proposal for the requests. I don't know if there is a and the proposal for the response here it is. And okay, I think this makes sense. Probably this is something that should have been added in the early days of PHP, but since it was never added, the idea is to add it now, despite the it's a bit late in the game. Anyway, it would probably be good for new implementations of the language. And it could also, for instance, if there was if this proposal is accepted, then frameworks could implement their fallbacks in case you are not running a PHP version that implements this built-in. I'm not sure if this was well accepted, because this is, I have not followed all thread, but as you mentioned here, somebody mentions PSR 7. The idea is to somehow make it more web server independent objects for the for the handling of the request and response methods. Okay, now we are going to start the PHP and JavaScript Innovation Award of this month. Back again with the Johnny Mast here that will help me to comment on the latest packages. This time we're going to comment on the nominees of July.
Yeah.
So July, the July ones were voted on August. Then in September the results come out. So there is no way we can influence the voting with our opinions here. That's why there is always this few months delay between the recording and the actual nomination. So let me share the screen here. We are going to start coming on the ones of July. In July we had like three in JavaScript Innovation Award. Johnny, which one would you like to comment?
Well, I would like to do the asynchronous function call by Andrea Stott.
Okay, can you share your screen?
So yeah, I will do that. So you guys can see my screen as well. Hold on, let me see. Yes, it looks like, let me enlarge the screen a little bit. Yeah, this should be okay, I guess. Is it readable?
All right,
here we have the asynchronous function call by Andreas Todd, and this fine gentleman, he is from Hungary, if I'm correct. Let me see, where was that flag?
Yeah.
I lost this flag. Hold up. Ah, there it is.
It's a
responsive website, of course. Hungary, yeah. So this is his class, and let me see, what position did he get? It was the, hold on, I can see it in your screen. He's the...
Yeah, for some reason it is not switching to your screen, but okay. I have forced to show your screen.
All right. So this gentleman, I think he won. Is that correct? I can see it on your screen. The asynchronous function call, rank number one.
Yeah. So you are seeing my screen.
Yeah, I'm seeing your screen in the Hangout. So,
I can see in live streaming your.
Yeah, no, this is the Hangout, not the live stream. So. This gentleman, won.
Oh, are you selecting the window in your screen? You probably should unselect on the corner below.
I think it should be fine. Yeah, I see it on the live stream. I can see what I'm showing.
Yeah, that's so, because I forced. Keep talking.
Okay, let's continue. This gentleman made a JavaScript asynchronous function call. So you would be able to, if I'm correct, to just chain all the JavaScript functions you have. And let me look at an example of that. Wait, this is something else I was thinking about. Hold on.
Yeah, in the bottom there is an example of how we call the chain functions. Yes.
Oh, right. Okay, this is actually kind of neat, really. It's just like jQuery does it as well, where you can just chain your functions calls. So you can see, he's calling this function three times in a row. And that that is called, it has a name, I forgot it, but yeah, that's this package. And let me see.
Yeah, I think the bottom also has some information, but I'm not sure if it has code. No,
I guess
not.
No.
Well, anyway, the idea there is just to call some function asynchronously, and it even has a timeout. And if the current function is not yet returned, it moves on to the next function.
Yeah, that's actually really nice.
It's a bit weird because in JavaScript you can do these things. Yeah. Okay. Right. On my behalf, I also like to comment on a couple of classes. I've seen my screen. Okay. Okay. The first one that I wanted to comment is this one named JavaScript Summarized Text from Everton da Rosa from Brazil. He basically implemented a sort of a parser for pages that traverses the DOM tree and extracts some elements that have a certain data tag. Let me see if the example here. Let's see if you have this data. Attribute here, data summary, it will extract this and provides a summary of the pages. And this could be useful to create tables of contents, right? Inserting the summary of the page somewhere in the beginning, for instance. I don't know if it generates links to the correct sections, but it's still useful. And for this, Everton has picked one book of choice from PAC, which is a well-known book publisher that has been sponsoring the Innovation Award for quite a while. So congratulations to Everton. And the next one that I wanted to comment is called JavaScript Manipulate Table. This one is from Miguel from Venezuela, and it is interesting because it's probably better to show an example here. It's basically a way to filter some elements and show them, well, do something useful with them. And this can be done in tables dynamically, and it allows to do many, many, many operations with tables, like adding and removal cells, and rows, and columns. Well, adding and removal columns, it's not a trivial thing, because the way tables are organized in HTML, it's more in rows, not in columns. So it does a work that is not trivial there. So congratulations to Miguel. Miguel did not pick a prize. And sometimes this means, in this case, it means he probably did not get an email to pick his prize. So if he's listening, contact back, because you are entitled to a prize. Now, let me go through the Innovation Award ranking by author. In 2016, we have had a higher number of submissions, but still Understoff is ahead with 6 packages and 22 points. Then Thierry Francois from France with 5 packages and 18 points. Juan Jose from Spain with 1 packet and 6 points. Martin Latter from the UK with 1 packet and 5 points. He's tied with Evaldo Zimanek from Brazil and Carl Holtz from Canada. In seventh, the SPR number is Soy Avel from, I think he's from France, but for some reason he omitted his country. Okay. Anyway, David Whitworth from Germany is tied with Pierre. And in ninth place, there is Everton Ross and Tilo Oski with impacting 3 points. By country, things are more or less tied, but just with a few differences. So far, Hungary with six packages and 22 points is ahead. Then second place, France with six packages and 21 points. Brazil with three packages and 10 points is in third place. Then Germany, two packages and 7 points. Spain and Mexico with 6 points, despite there's a number of packages submitted. Then United Kingdom with an unbracketed 5 points is tied with Canada. And there is a mysterious country here. Actually, this is a bug. Anyway, then Armenia with 2 packages and 4 points. So this is for the JavaScript Innovation Award. For the PHP Innovation Award, as you might know, many more people are participating, and in July we had like 11 nominees. And July, which was not even the best month there, I think it was in March, there are like 18 nominees, which was the record. So this is great because many people are sending great innovative packages. So let's take a look at these packages. Johnny, which ones would you like to comment?
Let me do the first five or six, okay. If I may.
Sure. Okay. It seems that for some reason I hope that it is capturing the audio, but for some reason I need to switch to your screen. So okay, I just wonder if you can enlarge your window, maybe maximize it
This would okay. Be
yes, and then increase the font.
Okay. All right. Well, this would be too big, I guess. Is this correct?
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
All right. Okay, here we have the winners of July 2016 on PHP classes. Number one, PHP Small Server Administrator by LSK. Hold on.
Probably Alexei.
Yeah, if you're watching, I'm sorry what I did with your name there. And Nimero from. Hold on. And he's from Russia. Okay. So what his package does is basically a system administration tool where you can monitor your processes. And what he got for it, he was number one. Yeah, July winner. And he got a one big elephant plush mascot. And I want one of these as well one day. So
you know what you have to do.
Alexei. Like crazy. So I'm really jealous.
Not necessarily many packages, just
good ones.
Innovative ones. I like surprising ones.
Yeah. So I'm trying to do that. But anyways, let's continue with this package. It has really good documentation if you look at it, and it will help you a lot if you're using this package. You can manage and see your processes, and yeah, it's pretty amazing. and it's not for, it's really a good package. It won, and in my opinion, it's totally deserved.
Yeah. Well, this is, I think this is mostly for Linux servers, like those running Debian or Ubuntu or maybe some other distribution, but it can also start and stop services. I guess it has requires some permissions because the regular web server user cannot run with enough permissions to start and stop services.
Yeah, at least it needs some permissions to set it up, because you need to run the sudo command, which is super easy to do. So, but I don't know if that if root access is needed in the while running. You probably can get around that if.
Yeah, it's just to start and stop process, because for monitoring processes, I guess any user can do that.
Yeah, there is a fair bit of documentation. I'm really happy to see that. As a user, I would be really comfortable with that. So, well deserved. Okay, let's see. Let's see another package. Jackson, call PHP classes from JavaScript using Ajax. And this is something I actually did myself a few years ago. And this is really cool. This is really cool. Jackson is from Cameroon. And he took the number 2 prize, a downloadable copy of the Komodo IDE. A really good IDE, if I say so myself. And he got this package into the second place by, let's see, let's look at the samples from it. Sample. Where is this JavaScript? Oh, wow. Look at this. A fancy interface. Look, almost looks like remote procedure calls. If I look at it like that, it basically is remote procedure calls. So, wow, that's really neat. That's really neat. I hope it's really secure as well. But on the other end, you have to look into your own security.
But yeah, still, that's up to you.
Yeah, that's up to you. And I really, really like the idea. Really good concept and really noticeable as well.
Yeah. Okay. So I've submitted other packages which are variants of this package, but they are more adapted to work with different frameworks like Zend, Laravel, and others, CodeIgniter, I think, too. Okay.
Yeah, well, if this is framework independent, it's even better, of course, because that's what makes it noticeable. You can take this and use it on any of your own projects.
Okay, so let me comment on also the remaining packages. I have already opened them here. I'm just not sure if it is sharing my screen. Is it okay, right? Is it sharing my screen for you?
Yes.
All right. Is it inceptioning? am I sharing the right screen? Let me restart the sharing, because in the live coding, it's doing the what you call the inception effect.
Yeah, I see it.
Okay. Okay. Stop screen sharing, start again. Which one is the one? Ah, okay, I think this is the one. Okay, it is okay right now?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me start commenting first about this package from Scott Arsuzuski. I'm sorry if not pronouncing his name correctly. He's from the United States. And he is actually a security expert. And he has been contributing a lot with proposals and discussions on the PHP core development. But in this case, he submitted a package that is called CMS Airship. And what it does is basically a content management system. It could like implement blogs or other types of content-based sites. But it has a focus on security. So it comes not only with some security features built in, but also it provides, I think it is a repository of plugins that are curated by him. So it's not like WordPress that you download WordPress and you can install any plugins that probably were not audited in terms of security. And this is a bit problematic because people that want to run a secure environment probably will never have one with WordPress unless there is some kind of curation. So this is the idea of this Airship CMS project, and it is great. And this package from Scott, he usually contributes his work and does not want to practice, just doing for the fun or the goal of the project itself. So yeah. Anyway, congratulations for his package. It actually got some high ratings because of this.
Is he the author of Lipsodium as well?
I'm not sure if you can say he's the author. I think he is the person that proposed it to be integrated build team.
Yep.
In PHP 7.1.
Yeah, I know his name from a few places, also I believe from podcasts, but that's a side comment.
Okay. Anyway, moving on to the next package. This one is called PHP Select Stressed Multi-Lazy Load, which is a package that implements REST APIs. This package from John Diaz from Colombia. There are many packages that implement REST APIs, but the way some are done, you need to load classes sometimes, even if they are not needed, they are just a reference, so they end up being loaded. So in this case, it implements lazy loading, because different requests to a REST API may be implemented with a separate group of classes, including microservices classes. So the idea of this package is to minimize the need to be loaded to implement different parts of an API. So this is an interesting approach to make it more efficient implementing REST APIs, in the case using the Silex framework. Let's move on and take a look at the Innovation Award rankings of the PHP. Are much more competitive because many more innovative packages have been submitted. And this ranking here already includes the nominees of August. And Christian Invig so far is ahead with 7 packages and 54 points. So it's quite ahead. Because he submitted many innovative packages, and I know there are a few more innovative packages in the queue, so he has been a great contributor. And he's followed by Bharat Parmar from India with 3 packages and 34 points. Dave Smith from United States with 4 packages and 32 points. Luciano Salvino, that we mentioned before, with 3 packages and 31 points. And Johnny Mast from the Netherlands with 2 packages in 28 points. If you double your score, you move on to the first place. So
I'm trying.
Okay, let's see what you still have 3 months to, including October, until the end of the year. So you still have chances to win. Anyway, Alex Demiro from Russia that you mentioned is next in sixth place with 2 packages and 27 points. Jeremiah Ogbomo from Nigeria with 2 packages and 26 points. Kasper Rowinski from Poland with 2 packages and 24 points is in 8th place. And Bruno Henrique Ferreira Oliveira from Brazil with 2 packages and 21 points is in 9th place. And finally, Andrea Battellocchi from Italy with 2 packages and 20 points is in 10th place. By country, the themes are not mapping one author to the country rank. So here we see Christian Vig in first place from France, but France is not the leading country. For now, Brazil is quite ahead with 9 packages and 100 points. But it's followed right after by United States with 13 packages and 91 points, and France with 11 packages and 79 points. Then comes India with 5 packages and 60 points, Russia with 6 packages and 59 points. The Netherlands is following with 3 packages and 42 points. So it's not just Johnny Master, it's another author from Netherlands that also sent packages. So the Netherlands is in 6th place, then Nigeria with 4 packages and 39 points, Italy 4 packages and 36 points, is tied with Argentina in 8th place, and finally Canada with 5 packages and 28 points. Anyway, well, with this we have practically ended this edition of the Lately in PHP podcast. I'd like to thank Johnny for showing up and filling in for Arthur, but you are always welcome to return every month, because since you are a PHP developer with a great experience, you can also help commenting on the topics.
Well, thank you.
So on my behalf, that is all for now.